request Director General CCS NIAM to present a bouquet as a token of gratitude. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, now I would request to Director General CCS NIAM to introduce the speaker. Please, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Satish. Warm welcome to 10th Krishi Gyan Deep Knowledge Series Lecture. It is for the information of honorable speaker and other guests here. What is the purpose of Krishi Gyan Deep Knowledge Series Lecture? This is a big country. We have 6.25 lakh villages and 130 million farmers. We have hundreds of agroclimatic zones. At the same time, to provide technology support, we have 76 agriculture universities and more than 400 agriculture colleges spread across the country. 120 research stations managed by ICAR organizations and 675 Krishi Vignan Kendras. You can just imagine the nook and corner of the country is covered by technology backstopping organizations. But when it comes to the question of adoption, it's only 25 to 40% of the technology is generated by all these research organizations are adopted by farmers. What about other 60 to 75% of the technologies? This is about organized research and extension and further dissemination and adoption by the farmers. But there are private organizations, agri business companies, private universities, donor agencies, nationalized banks, private banks, then input dealers, progressive farmers. There are hundreds of farmers producers companies nowadays. So there are hundreds and thousands of individuals and organizations are working for agriculture development. So how to reach? One side, technology generators, knowledge generators on one side, knowledge receivers on the other side, there is a huge gap in between. So as National Institute, we decided, let us try to minimize that gap by creating a platform in this auditorium. We try to bring the prominent speakers with rich experience. They share their life experience and that is converted into a film which is disseminated through ICT platforms, which is your favorite subject. So we have our own YouTube channel as well as the email IDs, which covers around 20,000 individuals and organizations across the globe. So this is the reach of this particular speech which we are going to deliver today. So when we started last year, we started with none other than Dr. Ashok Dalwai on doubling farmers' income on the day of Gandhi Jayanti, October 2nd. Very recently, the 9th Krishi Gyan Deep Knowledge Series lecture was delivered on a innovative concept called like family doctor, it is family farmer concept. So we keep on inviting and innovating and learning through this Krishi Gyan Deep exercise. So today's in this Dhanayagya, I think we have a very experienced professional in between us, and he is going to share his knowledge. So first of all, on behalf of NIAM, on behalf of all my colleagues and student friends, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Dr. Moni Madhaswamy again, and co-chancellor Dr. Sunil Chandra also to accompany him, and we have another important program afterwards. We are going to have MOU with Shobhit University, which is also part of this particular program. Now, before I request the Honorable Speaker, I would like to introduce the professional profile of Honorable Speaker before all of you. Professor Moni Madhaswamy is retired as former Director General of NIC, National Informatics Center, Government of India. He worked for 3.5 decades in the field of e-governance, informatics and agriculture informatics. See, our area of interest is good governance and agriculture informatics. His contribution is enormous. Realizing his contribution, in fact, the Good Governance magazine of September 2011 declared him as e-people of the month, that is September 2011. So the professor, you know, he once upon a time he worked with the former prime minister of the country, Mr. V.P. Singh. He was finance minister. He worked very closely with the former prime minister. Probably during his talk, you are going to share very valuable some of the experiences and exciting situation too for us. Professor Moni Madaswamy was also chairman of task force on IT in agriculture for Jharkhand, and also the task force constituted by Statistical Commission of India. And his great contribution was made while establishing 512 DIC centers on behalf of NIC throughout the country. Today we are talking about digital India, and unless we have digital connectivity at district level and below, for which DIC centers are playing very important role established by NIC. And today you have a person in front of you who established this network across the country. So actually his concepts on smart village and smart island projects, you know, caught the attention of policy makers. He received several awards like Sevaratna Award, Pugal Bhushan Award 2006, then Technology Museum Award USA 2004 and 2005, and 2019 ICT Leadership Award by IFAS, Agriculture Leadership Conclave, which held very recently. He is also chairman of IFAS Working Group on ICT, and member of Indigram Labs, honorary chairman of Ahimsa, it's a NGO in Chennai, and several other organizations. He joined Shobhit University as Professor Emeritus and Chairman of Center for Agriculture Informatics and E-Governance Research Studies. Afterwards, he initiated several centers of excellence, something around, you know, digital technology, and some are directly related to agriculture. Professor Moni Madaswamy was former Chief Advisor IT to Ministry of our own Ministry of Agriculture, and now he is Advisor IT to Delhi Development Authority. This is the brief profile of Professor Moni Madaswamy. Now I request the speaker to share his experience, and permit us, we will be audience, we will go in that side. Thank you very much.
Vice Chancellor, Shobhit University, Dr. M.I.L., Director, National Institute of Technical Marketing, other faculty members, and the dear students. It gives me great pleasure to come to NIAM to address you on the invitation of the Director General, Dr. Shigan, who is a good friend of mine. I have been visiting this institute since 1995 onwards, and we have connected so many, you know, workshop meetings and so on and so forth. Today, the relevant topic is digital technology in agriculture development strategy for doubling farmers in campaign 2022. Rightly, Dr. Chandrasekharam said it that we were involved in preparing the draft for formulating the doubling the farmers income in 2022 various subcommittees. I was the chairman of two subcommittees, one where Dr. Chandrasekharam was involved, that is an agricultural extension and ICT. Second one is digital technology in agriculture. And in that subcommittee, we have suggested about 7 mission board projects. We saw the digital technology as a the embodiment of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Today, agriculture and the related sector is nothing but a biological computing. As a person who was involved in about 512 districts computerization way back in 87, that was the District Information System Program of National Informatics Center, there I have promoted 28 sectoral database development programs. It was a very visionary project, and you can see that it's the first milestone and landmark of the present day e-governance program. Among 28 sectoral programs, two sectors were exclusively earmarked for agriculture sector: district information system for agriculture, district information system for animal husbandry, and district information system for fisheries. After operationalization of the listening program in 512 districts uniformly, and that time we didn't have the technology. We had a technology, a database product called FoxBase. But we were very strong in information systems. Foundation for any, you know, computerization, the building block is an information system, information modeling. Today you have technology. The time has come to concentrate on information system. In 95, when after operationalization of the district program in many districts, I realized that the whole world is talking about sustainable agriculture and rural development. Why can't India take a lead in bringing in IT in agriculture? See, Vigyan Bhavan, May 1995, we had a 2 days conference on informatics for sustainable agriculture development. Is done 95. Based on the recommendation of Rio 8 Summit 1992, which talked about in chapter 14, agenda 21, information system for sustainable agriculture and rural development. The conference at Vigyanberg was so successful, more than 550 people participated, and we brought out IT blueprint for agriculture sector. Many IT projects such as AgmarNet, AgriSnet, Fisheries Informatics Network, FishNet, Fertilizer Informatics Network, FertNet, and so on and so forth. 16 informatics network. India is the first country to visualize the need for IT in agriculture sector. We demanded 3 to 6% of the agriculture budget to be earmarked for IT in agriculture. The then central government, you know, sanctioned 2 to 3% of the government budget department wise for IT. That's how the e-governance program has picked up in a big manner. AgmarNet is a very successful project. AgriSnet is a very successful project. And in 2014, which has given birth to, you know, Electronic National Agriculture Marketing Project, ENA. AgmarNet is used technology, and that time we networked about 3,500 wholesale markets out of 7,000 wholesale markets. 400 agriculture commodities, 2,000 varieties information is available in AgmarNet. It's a big database available for any data analytics. And it was one of the very important projects for the whole world. In the, when the Doubling the Farmer's Income Committee was set up under the chairmanship of Dr. Ashok Dalwai, so they invited me to, you know, be the group leader for agriculture extension and ICT, and digital technology in agriculture. Agriculture extension and ICT is the volume 11, and digital technology in agriculture is volume 12. I request all the students of MBA in agribusiness management to go through these documents. Not only these two volumes, but other volumes too, you'll get a lot of real information available for your career growth. So let me limit it to the digital technology in agriculture development. The agricultural sector consists of agriculture, horticulture, sericulture, jute, floriculture, apiculture, livestock, dairy, fisheries, post-harvest management, marketing, processing. Then second category is agribusiness, value chain, supply chain. Now they talk about agriculture value systems. We talk about agriculture 4.0. Japan talks about society 5.0. And now, in the committee, we talked about agriculture 4.0. Now, the whole country is talking about industry 4.0. Which are all the technologies which can make agriculture as agriculture 4.0? You must have heard about green technology. How many of you have studied green technology? Can you raise your hands? India has seen the green revolution. We are self-sufficient in our food production and also in agriculture-related fruits and vegetables. Another revolution which is going to come is through, that is also called green revolution. That green is G-R-E-E-N, green revolution. This is G-R-I-N, genome, biology, robotics, R, I, informatics, and N is nanotechnology. The agriculture 4.0 is going to be the technology for taking India to be the food, basket, good food bowl for the entire world. So it is important for the students to understand the technologies such as genome, robotics, informatics, and nanotechnology. Which are all the other technology which is going to play? It is social networks, mobile technology, analytics, data analytics, big data analytics, video analytics, audio analytics, text analytics, then cloud computing, web technology, Internet of Things, IoT. How many of you had the terminology IoT? IoT is nothing but IT plus OT, information technology and operational technology. Then second, after IoT is web of technology, things. Then Web of Things is the web technology based, Internet of Things. Geomatics, application of GIS technology. Remote sensing, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning. expert systems, decision support systems, language computing, blockchain technology, and so on and so forth. India speaks about 22 constitutionally recognized languages. So if you'd like to talk to the farmers who are the first, you know, mile of our agricultural production, the digital technology has to talk to them in their own language. So language computing is more important. So Agriculture 4.0 is going to have these components of digital technology in a big manner. So that's why, you know, after my retirement, I thought that agriculture science so far has not made mathematics as a compulsory subject for the BS agriculture science students. So the time has come that both biology, chemistry, physics, and mathematics, you know, to be the compulsory subject for the students to get into agricultural science, because it is much more than the basic discipline, but it's now biological computing. So that's why the agricultural informatics as a discipline has been now evolved. This is the first center in the world, Center for Agricultural Informatics and E-Governance Studies, where we have introduced in the Soviet University B.Tech in Agricultural Informatics and M.Tech in Agricultural Informatics to train the plus two students in agriculture science, you know, those who study agriculture or non-agriculture native to agriculture informatics, and those who are B.S. Agricultural Science graduates to get into M.Tech in Agricultural Informatics. Now, which are all the seven mission board projects which we have suggested in the Doubling the Farmer's Income by 2022, so that every aspect of agriculture can be digitalized. So we have divided the entire agriculture stream into three categories. The first one is that digitalized agriculture, digital technology and innovation in agriculture, digital India, make in India, skill India, startup in India, how these four national programs can be, you know, integrated in such a manner that it can bring in transformational, you know, reforms in agriculture sector. So we suggested three major, you know, project: smart irrigated agriculture, smart rainfed agriculture, and smart tribal agriculture. Tribal agriculture is a sustainable agriculture development. So to make the boys and girls from the tribal sector to get into smart tribal agriculture system is the first time we have suggested that. Rainfed agriculture is also has to have a large scale digital technology, so the smart rainfed systems and smart irrigated agriculture. In 2002, when I was the Deputy Director General, I was given the agriculture sector, we suggested smart village program. One village in 28 states at that time, and then one village in Andaman Nicobar Island. This 29, you know, pilot project, we also categorized into about 90 to 20 typologies, so that this pilot project, if it is operationalized, it can be scaled up to, you know, throughout India. So about 90 to 20 typologies. The whole, you know, landscape of India has been, you know, divided. Now, during the, you know, initial remark, the Director General talked about that we have about something like, you know, 147 agro, you know, regional, you know, regions that, and about 15, country level agroclimatic regions, and now everybody is looking into that. how agriculture and health is going to be completely interrelated. So the smart agriculture is divided into smart irrigated agriculture, smart rainfed agriculture, and smart tribal agriculture, which can bring in Digital India, Make in India, Startup India, and Skill India to, can bring in lot of, relevance in these three categories of digital technology and agriculture system. Second mission or project is that digitalized agronomic advisories and agricultural risk management. So every farmer has to be linked with digitalized agronomic advisories and agricultural risk management systems. This can bring in a different set of agricultural startups. This can be a very good thing for agribusiness management, graduates that. Third is that the country does not have a comprehensive agricultural resources information system, because agriculture has to grow on land. You have to have a comprehensive natural resource management systems. Related to agriculture resources information system, there was a committee set up under the Planning Commission. I was the member secretary, and the report talked about comprehensively as to how to develop an information system to give it to the farmer, that what is available on the ground, what is available below the ground, and what is coming from the sky for the agriculture development. So this is an agricultural resources information system is a very important component to large scale adoption of digital technology in agriculture. So smart village project, which will be based on micro level planning and village level information system, and agricultural resources information system can lead to smart agriculture, smart farming. Smart farming is based on another 10 technologies. If you go through the report, these are all given in a pictorial format. So this is the third mission project, digitalized agricultural resources information system and micro-level planning for achieving smart village and smart farming. The directors and the generals talked about 6.2 lakhs villages, 6,500 blocks. We need to have as many number of agri startups in this area, depending upon each problems. Fourth is that digitalized agricultural value chain for 400 agriculture commodities. Each commodity, you are all agribusiness management, has got a different value chain. It is not a one value chain for all 400 agriculture commodities. Mango agriculture value system is different. Fisheries value system is different, and depending upon each, whether it is a marine fisheries or the inland fisheries, the value system is different. So agricultural AgMark system, that is Agriculture Marketing Information Network, AgMarkNet, has got 400 agricultural commodities and 2000 varieties information. So we suggested that now with the ENA, why can't we generate as many number of agriculture startup in this area, where agri-clinic has been established as a very important scheme at the grassroots level. So agri-clinic can come up one commodity for about one, in one block consisting of all the villages, farmers that. We have 13 crore farmers in the country. So you can be the, job generator. So the agriculture commodity, 400 digitalized agricultural, value chain from farmer to profits, farm to profits, about 400 commodities. It's a huge. For your information, Canada works on about 9 commodity value chain. They grow food for about 6 months. But in India, we grow agriculture commodities throughout the year. And we got so many agroclimate regions. Why can't we take benefit of this natural endowment? Fifth is that digitalized access to inputs, credits, finance, technology, seeds, so on and so forth. Knowledge, skill, agricultural finance, marketing, and agribusiness management to farmers. This is another area where it has opened up a lot of agribusiness aspects to the farmers. That is, today farmer has to go to the, you know, has to go to the financial institution for credit and finances. Based on his assets, why can't we work out an agriculture credit system to him? So it is a reverse flow, we should do that. And we have got about 13 crore farmers. How much business we can generate through the digital technology in a world. So this is another recommendation. Digitalized access to inputs, technology, knowledge, skill, agricultural finance, credit, marketing, and agribusiness management to the farmers. The sixth one is that how to bring in digitalized, integrated land and water management system per crop, more crop. So this is another area because in order to have an agricultural development, you have to have an, you know, comprehensive natural resource management. It means that we have to have large-scale application of digital technology and natural resource management. That's why in the other report, we suggested farm extension 4.0, where 11 categories of farm extension has to be promoted. So this is another very big area which has to be promoted. And the last one is that it is nobody talked about so far. I have been invited to present an invited talk in 2012 at Lucknow in the National Agriculture Science Congress to talk about how digital technology can facilitate loss reduction on farm. I thought that, you know, this is one area where the expenditure can be reduced, the loss can be reduced, is that if you adopt integrated farm health management. Today, the farmer has to look into plant health management as a vertical. Do you have good understanding about plant health management? Can raise your hands? Okay, this is a new area because plant health management itself is an, you know, is an important management, you know, aspect that. Tea as a commodity has got about more than 1,000 diseases. And plant health and animal health. If we would like to, you know, get into the world market, as per the OIE regulation, it's like an organization for animal health equivalent to World Health Organization for human health. They have notified about 143 animal diseases. So our animal had to be free from that. So Ministry of Agriculture, at that time in 2008 to 2012, operationalized National Animal Disease Reporting System, NADRS, networking 7,032 centers below, up to the level of block level veterinary offices in the country. That was the last project which I operationalized, and February 2013, May, I did it as Director General of National Aquatic Center. So this is another very important project where agribusiness management students should understand. Each disease can make you to get into agribusiness management startups. And it's not only 143 is internationally declared disease, but local diseases are more. We identified about something like 200, you know, animal diseases. That 80% of the disease which the common man gets in public gets, it comes from animal. If we would like to, reduce our budget for public health, we have to concentrate on animal health. So if animal disease quarantine takes place, automatically the human health gets increased. So animal health information system is more important. And third one is soil health. The country has now computerized soil health card. The soil health card alone can bring in. We got about something like 30 crore soil health card can bring in so much agribusiness startups based on soil health card itself. Then water health. Like we need micronutrients for our own health. The agricultural commodities also, crops also need, good quality water, which we don't even, look into the various nutrient parameters of the water which we give to the, animal or agricultural crops or even fisheries and fish health. Put together, I put it as an integrated farm health management system, which will facilitate, public health. So, if we concentrate a digitalized, integrated farm health management, we see that how our farmers can get benefit from their agricultural operations. Who will leave agriculture? These are all areas where the experts like you, who studied agricultural science, and then now come for 2 years of agribusiness management. These are all the problem areas for you to work, not the problem areas where you should run away. Digital technology can facilitate you. That's why with my vast experience and working grassroots level, I thought that doubling the farmer's income by 2022 can bring in a large scale benefit. It's not only the doubling the farm income, it is only the lowest slab. Some of the commodities can bring in more income, 5 times. If the time permits, I will also talk about one value chain which I have initiated, banana value chain. Banana is a one commodity. It is a perishable commodity. But the farmer can generate wealth out of the waste which comes from the banana. And this is very important. In the 30 states in India which grow banana, so many varieties. And in Assam, Golpara district, how many of you are from Assam?
I'm from Manipur.
Manipur, yes. Golpara is the largest banana market in Asia. Banana farmers don't get market value. But we can bring in a complete value chain. Banana, fabrics, banana plywood, banana paper. Apart from, the banana which we sell it for vegetable purposes and fruit purposes. That. And how much employment opportunities can be generated? Like that, every commodity can bring in a very effective value chain, which the youngsters like you should be in a position to do that. On 7th, we had a national conference in Delhi from Soviet University, with the NGO which is working in Northeast. We took up 3 commodity value chain. Assam imports 15,000 crores of fish from outside the state, Northeast region. 10,000 crores milk. 5,000 crores egg. 550 crores pork. From Punjab, they don't eat pork. The Punjab farmers went to Northeast, studied the ecology, studied the needs for farmer, the people there, and they developed poultry, you know, the pork farm in Punjab, and they, you know, exported to Northeast. One lady entrepreneur worked in MNC for about 15 years. Now, established a very modern, internationally, you know, with international standard, a pork farm in Assam. So, we have now taken inland fish as a one commodity, because which has got lot of, you know, world market, and spices, and the pork, beginning value chain. So, depending upon the local needs, what is available, what is being produced, this value chain has to be worked out. So, the last one is that digitalized farm health management for reduction of farmers loss on farm is, for me, is a very important, you know, area. So plant, you know, plant health, animal health, soil health, water health, fisheries health, and human health. Apart from this one, that two other entities which are needed is that comprehensive farmers' database. Unfortunately, the country does not have a comprehensive farmers' database. What is available on his farm? For the last 10 to 20 years, what is the problem which he has been facing? Why he changed the extension methods? Why he is not able to produce what the, you know, market needs? And next is that, what is the crop suitability, soil suitability? He doesn't know. And then next is that, farm dynamics. So, as an individual, as a technocrat, worked in agriculture sector, I have been voicing that there has to be a farm level database and farmers level database. As a chief advisor, IT for the Minister of Agriculture, during the doubling the farm income by 2022 committee report formulation, I even worked out the comprehensive parameters. And I call it as A to Z. Even many of the farmers do not even know all the national important programs of Digital India, Stand-up India, Startup India, Skill India program. So, youngsters like you can bring in, you know, this concept to the farmers in a very big manner. So, the farmers, you know, I can, you know, give the parameters to the, you know, Director General, that every one of you go through those parameters. See that as a group of, you know, first, you know, as a batch which you, you know, move, what you could do it with the parameters. We have an Aadhaar platform. Every Indian has got an Aadhaar platform. So with these 12 digits, everybody recognizes. All the traders today are being recognized by the GSTN number. Do you agree with me? Why can't the 13 crore farmers have a farmer's number? So that he gets recognized, which this number will give input related to his assets. So that whoever wants to help him will be able to talk to him. He has a mobile phone. You've got a land. I'm working on, you know, land management. We would like to help you. And this is how that the database, if it is available, will be in a position to facilitate. Now you tell me, I have just opened a Bandara box. I talked about 7 mission board projects. If next time if it is available, I can talk to you for a whole one day on many other aspects that. You have 7 mission board projects. You have 13 crore farmers, you have a comprehensive database based on the parameters. And farm database. If these three components are available, how many startups can we generate? This is what, even in the agriculture extension, we thought that this can go through the 11 aspects of farm extension. This is a farm extension 4.0. And if that is done, digital technology in agriculture can bring in a mass movement in the country. And, you know, we don't have to look for a job outside. Every one of you can be an entrepreneur at the grassroots level. It is something like Dr. Abdul Kalam talked about that urban facilities to be made available in rural area. Rural India can facilitate urban India. So through the agricultural systems. Extras, you know, when you go to rural areas, I'm able to see their rural distress on them. So I thought that after my retirement, I thought that I should also work with them through this, you know, digital technology in agriculture. You know, how they can be converted as an entrepreneur, taking agriculture development through IT in a big manner, through informatics. So it is not going to stop with agriculture informatics, it's a broader term. Hartnett is one of the paper which has been written by me, is being, you know, seen in many other aspects that you can put a Hartnett in the, you know, Google engine and you'll be able to get almost all the, you know, topic. Second one paper which I thought that for the developing countries that what India has done it, that African Asian Rural Development Organization, ARDO, has published one of my papers. This is for IT blueprint for developing countries in the agriculture sector. That paper is also available. If you read that one, it's about 35 pages. It will give a very comprehensive idea for you to understand IT in agriculture and take your own course, because you are an MBA in Agri Business Management and you are a BS Agriculture Science graduate. So you will understand much better than, you know, the people. So these are all some of the things that which I thought that I should, you know, talk to you during the time which has been given to me. This will facilitate, because why the 7 mission board project? The entire Doubling the Farmers' Income Committee report talks about seven major sources of growth. So one is that improvement in crop productivity, improvement in livestock productivity, resources efficiency or saving in cost of production, increase in cropping intensity, diversification towards high-value crops, improvement in rail prices received by farmers, and shift from farm to non-farm occupations. Taking this as a cardinal principles, we thought that how these 7 mission board projects in digital technology and agriculture can facilitate that. So, in the short time which has been given to me, I was able to give you an overall scenario as to how digital technology and agriculture can bring in large scale employment, first, large scale startup in agriculture sector. One commodity value chain in one block can bring in about something like 20 agriculture startups. And 11 mode of farm extension. So this is, everything is a multiplier factor, which we can do that. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to talk to you briefly. And the country expects a lot from you and from the youths, and digital technology in agriculture can make you, you know, as an entrepreneur, and you can put more money into the pockets of the farmer. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your word of wisdom, and I believe that our students and audience will get enlightened with your words of wisdom. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. I am Nidhi from second year. I have a question that there are many theoretical assumptions or techniques or technologies which are thought of, but how are they planning to bring it in practicality? Like, since we know that most of the farmers do use mobile and they have data connectivity in their phone, but they are not connected through to any agricultural related applications or things like websites which give agricultural information. So how are you planning to get in touch with the farmers to disseminate this knowledge in practicality? Like, what are the steps taken to give them, to make them use this technology, whatever is brought in?
I also talked about language computing. You have technology and it has to go to him in his own language, to his problem. It is not that one size fits for all. If a banana farmer has got a different problem, he is a poultry farmer, he needs agronomic advisories that during summer, when the heat is more, what type of food, feed you should give it to the poultry. So it is something like a localized input needs to the farmer, advisory systems. Today, what we give is that the general, you take advisories, we get more, you know, meteorological advisories. It is not specific to the potato farmer. It is not specific to the, you know, poultry farmer. It is not specific to the particular commodities. So we have to give this one, he has a smartphone. So we have to reach to him with respect to his problem for his agricultural practices. That creating a website is fine. The government departments use these websites as the Facebook further. Once again, if you want to visit this, I was the creator of the, you know, the first website for NIC. We are the IT people. And that has become, there is a Facebook for almost all government departments. So it is brought in a lot of information dissemination. But that's why when I said it, that I set up a Center for Agriculture Informatics and E-Governance Research Studies. The e-governance has to be put on agricultural information. Farmer has to be considered as a citizen, he has a citizen right, citizen charter. So he has to get all the information in time with respect to his problem. Then only this technology will be meaningful to him. So your question is more appropriate. So that's where the startups has to function like an agri clinic, working with the farmers, with the technology available in his own language. Language computing is more important. Does it address you, your question?
Sir, but there are startups which are in regional languages, but they are trying to connect with farmers, but it is not possible to connect with everyone. So what is government going to do about connecting the farmers with this information? There is information, there is technology, there are startups like AgroStar, if I should name. They have it in regional language, but farmers are not using it. How will government make farmers use it? Like, how will government make farmers understand that this is the place where they can get the information?
One is that we have 13 crore farmers. So until unless we have his assets, the 13 crore farmers information, even the government may not be in a position to reach him. He has a mobile phone. Now with a smartphone, he is completely empowered. So the e-farmer, he has to become an e-farmer. So we have to have his information on farm, farmer-based information and farm-based information. Somebody has to do a data analytics on his, you know, input, which he gives it. And he will be served depending upon that the people who work in the form of startups and so on and so forth. For example, I conducted a study during this doubling the farmers income committee report. Logical farmers, that's about 1% of the total farming community, they got almost all facilities. 85% of the farmers are small and marginal farmers. And rest is other kind of farmers. So this 85% of the small and marginal farmers, we have to help them through only through the information delivery of the right type of information delivery target to this problem. So we have to reach him. He is not the last mile, he is the first mile. So this type of citizen charter has to come that he is the first mile and we have to reach him. Today, you know, the director general talked about there are about 675 Krishi Gyan Kendras. Every district has got an accreditation technology management agencies, ACMA Center. Every national, every public sector bank has to give 18% of their agriculture credit for a primary sector lending. And we got about something like 1 lakh primary agriculture cooperative societies. Even with this one, still farmers are the last mile connected. So, only the agriculture startups will be in the position to have something through the form of agri-claiming, collect about 5,000 farmers, 2,000 farmers, will be in the position to reach to the farmers. Lot of data comes from the remote sensing satellites. Now, how many institutions can interpret that data and make it available to the, you know, farmers? You are an agriculture science graduate? Yes. Have you been taught on you know, GIS technology and remote sensing technology?
Yes.
Have you been trained on how to interpret this imageries? So, until unless we study technology, until unless we interpret that technology outputs for the farmers, how the farmers will understand? This is where the agri startups can facilitate. Agri clinic can facilitate. So, with the technology which is available, when we started in 87, we didn't have the technology. Today, you have almost all technology tools is available in open forum, open technology. And that is also accessible technology. Blockchain technology, I just mentioned it. Agriculture sector is a one sector which needs blockchain technology in a very important manner for traceability. Agriculture commodities needs to be traced. The traceability has to be, you know, ensured. So we have to reach farmer only through the database standards. And this database has to, you know, reflect what is real problem. Fine? Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Ravnath from Gash 1820. Sir, my question is, what is your view on zero budget natural farming? Will it lead to the doubling of farmers income?
Of course, this is a terminology which has been used in our budget also this time. But now I think they have changed the terminology from zero budget to something else now. No. You leave the part zero budget. At the gross level, natural resource management is more important. Agroecological based farming is more important. And that's why the agriculture resource management system is more important. So, India is a country that most of the parts, we don't use much fertilizer. Even the existing commodities, if its value system is developed, farmers can have a very good market realization. So, even, you know, I don't want to, you know, talk on the terminology on zero based budgeting, farm budgeting. But until unless we work with the farmer based on his resource management, upliftment of a particular farmer is a difficult process. because today it's a sustainable agriculture and rural development. Land is planned. And how to bring in knowledge-based system on the land use planning for sustainable agriculture and rural development. At the village level, people working for agriculture rural development, they have to be taught on sustainability, sustainable development programs. When you introduce the concept of sustainable development, all other things are all derivatives. Fine? All other things are derivatives. So, effective knowledge-based land use planning for sustainable agriculture rural development is more important. Fine? Thank you.
Hello, sir. Good evening, sir. I am Professor. My question is, as we have said that like every traders and all has been recognized by its own GST number. Likewise, farmer also in future this should have a farmer's number. So is it so that like we are discussing about theoretically, or is it so that this can be achieved practically?
It is achieved. It's achieved that if I can send the note to Director General, he can put it in the website or we can circulate it. See, if a doctor has to treat a patient for his ailment, he has to know his complete disease profile. No? So if you would like to work with a farmer, we would like to know his agricultural resources. We would like to know what is the problem he is facing. We have to record it. Why he changed his extension methods for the last 10 to 15 years? Right? So, we should know. And then, with the present entourment, how he can be engaged. So, you take Israel. You know, they have adopted per crop, more crop. If they get less rain, every farmer gets an advisory system that this time the water availability is only for 3 months. You grow only that crop which needs only for 3 months. For 3 months of water availability. So this is what we have to do that. So until unless, and today it's very easy that almost all farmers have got a mobile connectivity. And if it's not a mobile connectivity, now with the Bharat net, you know, every village panchayat will be having a high speed connectivity. So even in my report, I even suggested that Bharat net should be dedicated to the farmers. Then you grow farmers. And every farmer should be given an email address apart from the farmer number, like an Aadhaar number. So that the government has to have a continuous dialogue with the farmer. Crop after crop. So he needs an email address with the government. He needs to have a farmer number like Aadhaar or GST number. So that he can be, addressed properly. And, agri startups will be in a position to, work with these farmers in a very effective manner. And value systems can be established. So this linkages has to be established. So that's why farm database and farmer database is more important. Right? Yes.
So in modern farming, we all are talking about GIS and GPS type of farming, like we will be using modern equipment. But in India, we don't have our type of, GPS system of farming. And all the data which are collected because of GPS and all those things on the agriculture is utilized by bond companies. And they are just directly tapping our input companies. So there must be some infrastructure, or is there any work regarding this direction or not?
We also have a serious concern. That the government is taking all steps that our data should not go to the servers which are located in foreign soil. I was one of the person who was against putting our attribute data on Google Map. Previously, I used to upload all my published papers on the website. Today, I have to pay for to download my own papers. You go to academic.au, they will say that, okay, fine, your paper is having vast reading, but now you pay $10. So ISRO has come out with a technology, GPS technology, and which has been now approved in the whole body, standards body. And they have a device which is called Gyaan device, which even give the GPS coordinates to the highest accuracy, much better than what is available in our mobile phone. So the technology now it will be spread up. We are also trying to promote this Israel, you know, ISRO technology based GPSs in a big way. So this is one. And we also should develop technology. See, money, where is the money? Is not a technology adoption, it's technology development. Right? See, students like you should develop technology based on problems. Don't look for immediate, you know, solutions that. Always work for some sort of a short, you know, medium term and long term problems that is more important. So once you develop algorithms, based on which you develop products, which can give you value. Right? See, a smartphone, which you have, any phone which you buy it, that 10% of that value goes as a royalty to all the patents which is being used in that smartphone, you know, the phone. So in agriculture product, agriculture varies, even IT-based products. We should have our own innovation, right? Try to use our own technology if it is available. But data analytics itself can bring you lot of value. In all agriculture subsectors. This is my, you know, humble request to all of you. Take one commodity, one district, study the whole value system. You'll be a successful, you know, business, you know, management. You also read some of the, you know, the latest, our Professor Abhijit's, you know, Banerjee's, you know, later he got the Nobel Prize. Now he worked, he's in you know, various work he has done it in India, he got the Nobel Prize there. There are some of the, you know, leading lights through their work, we should understand that. So, you know, agriculture, you know, I am a mathematics student. I am not an agriculture scientist. I did my MS Mathematics, then M.Tech Computer Science from IIT Chennai, 76, 78 batch. Now I'm 66 plus. So, the whole world, whole India has got changed. And now we are looking towards you, people, youths, to understand technology and generate technology. That is more important. Fine? Thank you very much.
Professor, thank you very much for very difficult subject made simple before us. I know digital technology, of course, many apprehensions are raised by our students to what extent we can take it to the doorstep of commerce. But you made it very simple, highlighted new dimensions of digital technology in agriculture development. But every component is a topic for discussion for one day. So it is such a topic of, length and breadth. Probably in some other occasion we can have more detailed information, but we can treat it as a very good introduction to digital technology in agriculture development. Thank you very much all the way for coming from Shobhit University and sharing your 3.5 decade experience in agriculture, digital technology and agriculture development. Thank you very much. Now I request our Honorable Director General Sir to facilitate today's speaker, Professor Moni Madhuswamy, by offering a safa and a token of respect.